for the first 6 years of my life, I took no interest in music or art or anything of that sort. But I was a model child. I hardly ever spoke. I was the joy of my father and the worry of my dear mother. But when I was six, I was taken to a concert, and I heard some music, Grieg on the piano. And when I got home, I couldn't forget the music. And I got up, out of bed, went downstairs, walked into the drawing room, where about a dozen people, and said, I want to learn the piano. Well, that was a great shock to everyone.
His father nourished a passion for musical boxes and mechanical contrivances of every description, and the house in St. Helens almost overflowed with them.
There was an immense musical box called an orchestra, and this reproduced the sound of about 50 instruments. And it played all sorts of selections from operas by Wagner and Verdi and others. And that I loved. In other words, my first real love of music was opera.
Each time his father returned from his frequent business trips to the USA, he brought home some new American invention. Thus, they had a system of central heating when such a thing was unknown in this country. Also in their home, they had one of the first private electric lighting plants. As a present, his father brought him an electric organ, one of the first invented. When I played on it one December night, all the lights of St. Helens were extinguished. In time, he was duly dispatched to a public school, Rossall, but his Christmas holidays were spent in an orgy of opera going. In due course, he went up to Oxford, whence he came down after only a year, for the simple reason that he could discover among his fellow undergraduates no intelligence which didn't indicate permanent adolescence.
The average university-educated musician is a case of arrested development, emotionally, aesthetically, and sexually.
His father's views on education were totally practical.
Look here, lad. I've been spending a lot of brass on thy musical education, and now thou canst help me. Go through Christmas carols and alter some verses so as to advertise business.
So I retired to my study, and after some meditation, produced the following. Hark, the herald angels sing. Beecham's pills are just the thing. Two for a woman. One for a child. Peace on earth and mercy mild. This sensitive combination of religious sentiment and business sense bore immediate fruit and helped to expand the family's already flourishing business in St. Helens.
Thomas's father was mayor. He had influence, position, and money. He also had a habit of getting his own way. So, when a visiting conductor fell ill, this provided an opportunity for Thomas to conduct the Halle Orchestra. The idea was opposed.
Well, that annoyed my father, so he simply said, well, now my son's going to conduct the orchestra, whether you like it or not. So if you don't like it, you can stay away and I'll bring an orchestra from London.
Wanted his own orchestra all the time. He wasn't too happy with playing with the existing orchestras. Not that they were not fine orchestras, they were, but he always wanted his own players and to have them around him all the time.
All his life, Beecham formed orchestras. In 1898, a semi-professional society in St. Helens. In 1905, an orchestra for the Queen's Hall and the new symphony orchestra. In 1908, he founded another, the Beecham Symphony Orchestra. In 1932, the London Philharmonic, and in 1946, the Royal Philharmonic Orchestra.
Because to me, in those early days, he was always frightening. You see, I always thought that he was a musical genius. And although I can also think that at times I thought perhaps he was rather a cruel perfectionist. It would be a dreadful thing to say that you hadn't pleased Tommy Beecham.
I had been at it, experimenting with orchestras for about 2 years. There being no models in England at that time, I wasn't at all sure that I wanted to go on with it. And then Delius came along, he attended my concerts, and he said, what's worrying you? He said, you know as much about music now as any of these other fellows do. Go on with it, you've got a great career. He encouraged me that way. And so I finally decided, during the course of the 12 months I met, after I met him, 1908, I would stick to it, and I went into it with, as they say, with both hands and feet.
Within a few years, the name of Beecham, hitherto associated with the physical health of the nation, now became synonymous with its musical well-being. Almost a living parody of that well-known remedy, he, Thomas Beecham, set out to abolish musical flatulence. Granted, he started the hard way, at the top, but he stayed there all his life. In those early years, sometimes with, but often without, his father's money, he personally made things happen. He engaged orchestras, he hired singers, he rented theatres and opera houses, and brought to this nation the most astonishing achievements of the musical world. By the time he was in his early 30s, Beecham had tackled an enormous range of music, most of it contemporary music. Works such as A Village Romeo and Juliet, Sea Drift, and The Mass of Life by Delius, The Wreckers by Ethel Smythe, and Holbrook's Apollo and the Seamen. He also performed the Berlioz Te Deum, Mozart's Seraglio, Così fan tutte, and Figaro, and the operas of Richard Strauss, Elektra, Feuersnot, Salome, and Rosenkavalier.
At rehearsal, we just commenced to play, and this was all new to us. And after a little while, you know, he always made us work like mad. I mean, if something was loud or anything, he'd just go on and say, "Do your worst, gentlemen, come on, do your worst," you see. And we did our worst on many occasions. But I remember after a little while, we'd been playing for a quarter hour, 20 minutes, and he suddenly stopped for something, said what he had to say, and then said, "Right, now we'll commence from number 32. That is where you sing so-and-so, you sing so-and-so, you play so-and-so, and of course you have 20 bars rest." Well, we just sat there or stood there absolutely staggered at how a person, and his score was not open. I mean, he had this score there, but it was all from memory on this first appearance.
Salome scandalized London. Previously, the Lord Chamberlain had banned it. When finally Beecham was allowed to produce it, the gory head of John the Baptist was tactfully replaced by a cloth daubed with tomato ketchup. Elektra, with its lurid story and blood-curdling music, was the most discussed event of 1910. But perhaps his greatest achievement of those early years was to persuade his father to bring to London Diaghilev's Russian ballet. Was Diaghilev good to work with?
Yes, he was on the whole. He was very intelligent, he was very obstinate, he was very opinionated, but he was very efficient.
What were his special talents, do you think?
His special talent was discovering other people's talent.
I don't think you'll ever get another 9-week season like that with so much money lost. At a big banquet at the end of the season, everybody was asked, stagehands, property people, everybody and any connection at all with the theatre was asked. And Tommy's father, Sir Joseph Beecham, confessed that he's absolutely delighted with the success of the season. He'd only lost 75,000.
Money didn't mean the same to Sir Thomas as it did to the rest of us. He never had a bean in his pocket. He'd always have to run upstairs to borrow the taxi fare whenever he got to his destination, because money to him was something you spent in a big way, £600,000 at a time on an opera or something of that sort. If possible, it could be somebody else's money, but he used to spend his own as well.
There wasn't an individual except myself from the country in those days, an individual who was interested in opera to a large extent. And also in those days, there was no such thing as an art council or public funds. When the first war transpired, every single musical organization in England stopped. The Halle Orchestra stopped here, and I carried it on for 6 years myself, my own expense. The Philharmonic Society in England, London stopped. I carried it on at my expense for 5 or 6 years. There was nobody.
I remember his addressing the Musicians' Union on one occasion when I was there and telling them that he'd been in touch with his accountants who had informed him that he had spent £842,000 of his own private fortune on live music. Now, that's pretty good.
Ah, Sir Thomas, I've been going through your affairs at some length, and there is just one small point I would like you to enlighten me upon. Do you owe, or are you owed, £2 million?
The answer in both cases is in the affirmative.
The case went into Chancery, where the fact emerged that Sir Thomas had spent a large part of his private fortune on music.
And what was the good of that?
I've figured in 591 legal cases.
Of which I hope you won the majority.
I don't know. I think quite a number, yes.
Quite a number.
I think all I deserve to win.
In the old days, you know, in the days of the Beecham Orchestra, people would say, oh, Sir Thomas, you owe me 5 guineas for this. And he'd open his desk drawer, which was full of fivers, and give the man 5 guineas, regardless of whether it was right or not.
Even those people that had been owed money 3 or 4 years, perhaps, back, you see, still played for him. Because, to tell you the truth, they loved him. They liked playing for him, that's the point. Tommy treated us like human beings, so we treated him the same way. Difficult to treat a conductor like a human being, I know, but still, there it is.
Musical events in those days were also glittering social occasions. Even members of the royal family were then almost as interested in opera as some of them now are in racehorses.
George V came for a few times in the year. I always felt more as a matter of duty. But he was very meticulous about certain things in this royal opera house. One evening he said, you know, I want to tell you, I noticed a man in the orchestra who was not wearing a white waistcoat. Would you mind mentioning that to whoever it is who looks after these things? I said, certainly. He noticed that.
Did he have many comments to make about the music?
Sometimes he likes them, some things. I asked him one evening, what was his favorite opera? He said, La Bohème. Sort of a natural thing, sir. So I said, may I take the liberty of asking you, sir, why is this your favourite opera? He said, oh, yes, that's easy. It's the shortest I know.
Expect me to sing in this position.
Rubbish. In that position, I have given some of my very best performances.
We were terrified of him.
He looked when he sat down and this little thing here, you know. I mean, he looked so distinguished and elegant that you immediately felt, well, this was something. And anyway, we were terrified of him. This aria I was singing high notes and low notes. And who should come in while I was singing but Sir Thomas? And he shouted from the back of the hall, what the hell is he, a tenor or a bass? Well, that was my first meeting with Sir Thomas. And the final thing was when he shouted from the auditorium, what the hell is he singing, Messiah in Welsh? So that was my first encounter with him. And I can assure you, I hated him.
House ballet music. Bum. One of the bar. Used to be, anyway. Do I spy a new face amongst the woodwind? My name is Beecham. What's yours?
Ball, Sir Thomas.
I beg your pardon. Speak up, can you?
Ball, Sir Thomas.
How very singular.
Mm-hmm.
There is a rumor abroad that I am prejudiced against women in my orchestras. I can only suppose that it must be because their presence imposes restrictions upon one's vocabulary in rehearsals. A woman is a danger to an orchestra, and if she is not a danger, then that orchestra is not fit to be called an orchestra. The man who is not thrilled to the bone by the spectacle of a woman playing the flute, blowing the clarionet, or struggling with the intricacies of a trombone is no man. And in any case, no woman is worth the loss of a good night's sleep. At this point in the proceedings, you are hoping, no doubt, to hear a scurrilous and indecorous remark addressed to a lady cellist. Eh?
Optimist.
Even during his lifetime, the vast repertoire of Beecham rehearsal stories achieved the status of legend. They mostly demonstrate the incredible bond that existed between Beecham and his musicians, a bond based on professional and mutual respect.
Was the master of the house front and back. He was quite imperious about it. I remember starting a second act of something at Covent Garden one night, and there was a door open, and he turned round and flung out his hand and said, "Door!" Just like that. And some gentleman or other in full evening dress in the front row of the stalls got up and closed the door. He said, "Thank you, sir," very loudly. Then on we went with the show. But he mastered the whole thing. He would not be talked to by anybody at all. The whole thing was his responsibility, and it bore the stamp, it bore the Beecham stamp.
He just took everything. He knew he wanted the best performance that was possible, and if he got that, he would just make some remark. It may be very sarcastic, very sarcastic. You think, well, he's not pleased, but you see the way, the expressions and things like that, you knew jolly well he was pleased.
There's only one way to rehearse an orchestral piece, which is what I do.
What's that?
I take either a Mozart symphony or a Strauss tone poem. I play the whole thing through from beginning to end without a stop. Oh, blessed thing. The orchestra makes a few mistakes, naturally. I play it through a second time. The orchestra makes no mistakes. I then just take a few little difficult parts. I pinpoint them. I emphasize them. I repeat those three or four times. I really perform. What does a young conductor do? Who will never profit by anybody else's experience,
naturally,
thanks to his unconquerable egotism and innate stupidity. Yes. He will take a first class orchestra, and after playing 20 bars, he will stop, and he'll begin educating them. Fancy educating a body of people like the Royal Philharmonic Orchestra. They already know the damn piece 10 lines better than he does. He goes on another 20 bar, stops, starts educating, teaching them. That's why he wants six rehearsals, and that's why I can do with two.
He just painted a glorious picture all the time. There's the story of that young conductor up in Edinburgh listening to one of our rehearsals, and he said to me, I knew him, he said to me at the break in the rehearsal, my son has just said to me that he thinks that anybody listening to a rehearsal directed by Sir Thomas Beecham would learn a great deal about English and very little indeed about conducting and music, and a most asinine remark. But he said there were things going on behind that first desk of fiddles that he knew nothing at all about. Well, of course there were, but I mean, they play about a little bit sometimes. They lose interest once or twice in a rehearsal, and they don't always bow exactly together. But these were little details. That man was straining out gnats and swallowing camels. The big picture was Sir Thomas's the canvas, the whole thing. And as I said, his baton was a paintbrush, and we were the colours. And he painted the colours. And he left it to us. The recreative artist must have some freedom. And he gave us that freedom. In other words, quite simply, he let us play.
But when you come to face the orchestra, signs are not very much. Facial expression is immense. I remember conducting the Berlin Philharmonic Orchestra years ago. I had some difficulty making myself understood in German because of the strange German technical musical expressions. Dreadful. Nothing less than 12 syllables long, you know. So finally a man got up and said, "Sir, you need not tell us anything. We know exactly what you want from your facial expression. The face and the eyes are everything."
We knew what he was getting at. We only had to look at his face, look at his hands, and it was all right. He was so sympathetic, so helpful, so magnetic. He took us through everything, and we always gave him 100%. We couldn't help it.
He had the most beautiful way of molding his hands and drawing little pictures with them, which gave you exactly the sort of shape you know he wanted you to give him back in sound.
He always said, "I've got a damn bad beat." Always did say that. And it is very difficult for someone, until they were initiated, to know what he was doing. It was a technique entirely of its own. It was a Beecham technique.
"I'm afraid I can't see your beat." "My dear boy," was the reply, "you've been managing without it for years." You know, this is true. One got what one wanted from him. He was clear. But to be able to do brrr was much more evocative than to do bump.
You must remember that players, once they've got to a really high state of proficiency, don't need a beat. In fact, I would really go so far as to say that no really great conductor, in my experience, has ever had a very clear beat. Fürth Wengler used to have one like a sort of sloppy stroke of lightning, starting from the top and wandering down.
One realized exactly what Beecham was after when he was conducting, and he nursed you along, and you felt up to a point you were doing a similar thing for him, that you were both going along together with complete understanding. And I think that was the secret of so much of his success. He did make you feel that what you were doing, you were really doing yourself.
There is a link between an intelligent player and a first-class orchestra, which, after all, this orchestra is. And when I'm talking about orchestras, I differentiate enormously between the idea of an orchestra as an institution motivated by, controlled by, influenced by an irresponsible, idiotic union, and a group of very highly sensitive musicians who are always agreeable. Unfortunately, in most countries now, these excellent people are under the influence of silly, ignorant, common, obstructive, oppressive, and revolutionary nitwits and asses. And that applies to the entire world. And that's the curse of the profession. But the men themselves are individually admirable. Now then, these people, notice my expression. Yes.
And also, there's the link between us, by which what I'm thinking, with fierce concentration, everything in me, that's communicated to them, and they know. Most of them know.
Very often at the end of a rehearsal, you had no idea what the performance was going to be. You went onto the platform, and you discovered that the parts had been remarked in the afternoon between the rehearsal and the show. And at night, everything became crystal clear and infinitely more exciting than if you had had it cut and dried.
The first requisite in a conductor is that you should know the music. And that is a much rarer circumstance than one would imagine. I don't mean knowing only the notes, but you must have over a period of years, if necessary, absorbed the meaning of the notes. And you must be prepared in your mind to play those notes, whether it's those of Mozart or Haydn or Beethoven or Strauss, in 50 different ways.
He suddenly did something which had never been rehearsed at all. I mean, some little movement or some little crescendo or decrescendo. But it would come off because he felt it so tremendously that he sent it over to you and you couldn't help feeling it yourself. When he comes onto the platform, you feel, well, here's a chap I've known for years and years and years. He seems to be so much more one of the family.
What level is that?
Magic wand building.
What?
Magic wand building.
Cigarette. Oh. I thought it was an automatic baton, which relieved me of any responsibility and duty. I trust you realize, gentlemen, after saying good morning, that an solemn, important, and impressive occasion. I've spent half a sleepless night looking forward to it. With mingled emotions of curiosity, delight, and horror. Now, what do we play?
He marked with blue pencil scores and parts down to the last inch. Hairpins up and down, marks of every kind. The only sufferer, of course, was dear George Brownfoot, his long-suffering librarian, whose job it was then to take in the parts and correct it all.
Of course it's too high. What do you think I am? Samson?
Sometimes. Sometimes he would appear, even at the performance, and appear 2 minutes to 8, walk along the passage and shout out, Mr. Brownfoot! I've put in a few marks. And I used to have to go on the stage and collect in all the parts, ask them to pass them up, collect the parts in, sedately make my way off the stage, and then run like the very fury into his dressing room and start working. I would then go along on the stage, and while the applause was taking place, hand the music out to the orchestra. Thomas, at one period, was living at Ringmer at a house called Dells, when all at once a bugle split the silence of the air. So Sir Thomas stuck this as long as he could. At the finish, he could stand it no longer. And he strutted out onto the village green to find a boy scout, a little wee boy scout, playing a bugle or practicing a bugle. When he could, Sir Thomas said, Boy, stop that infernal din. And the boy looked and said, The trouble with you, sir, not knowing to who he was talking, the trouble with you, sir, is you don't understand good music.
Good music is that which penetrates the ear,
with facility and quits the memory with difficulty.
The end of the concert, hoping that I'll talk to them. They're not so much interested in the music. It would be a little... They like to be flattered, insulted, chivvied, teased, told paradoxes and things they don't understand, other cryptic utterances.
And it used to go on from one encore to two encores to three encores. Then he would come off and say, I think I'll talk to them now. And sometimes he would hold his hand up and say, put his hand up, and the audience would be very quiet. And he'd say, go home!
Tommy would tend to plan programs which contained a very large number of 10-minute or 15-minute items. The kind of work, like I've mentioned already, I think Sibelius's Tapiola, or Eventyr of Delius, or Little Piece of Masne, these famous lollipops that are so well known, they were not just pieces that he liked, they were the essence of his program building. He rather preferred that kind of program to one which might contain some mammoth symphony.
He had this wonderful gift of sorting out music that wasn't quite of the top level, and then suddenly making you realize that this was probably well worthwhile serious attention and could even be a minor masterpiece. I'm thinking of things like the Goldmark Rustic Wedding Symphony, things of that type, and little bits of Saint-Saëns that other people skimped over. He made into works of tremendous stature and brilliance. His knowledge of instrumentalists was infinitely superior to his knowledge of singers.
He always tried to get a little bit more out of a singer than he did out of his orchestra. I don't know what it was, whether it was because the singer was trying to shoot a line or something, I don't know. But I've seen some people have very awkward moments with Beecham.
This was a known fact, anyway, with Sir Thomas, that if he started doing things to you, then you just started answering him back. I don't mean in a rude way, but at least to stand up to him. And I think he accepted this. I think he wanted this, you know. The only thing it was that you never knew what he would shout from the pit.
Once we were doing the Cavalleria and Pagliacci, and I was singing the Santuzza in the Cavalleria, and Gigli and Maria Caniglia were doing the Pagliacci. And of course, being the international season, they had donkey and cart and bills printed and so on. And the first chorus in Pagliacci, sometimes it is rather difficult and sometimes doesn't go too well. And I remember this particular morning, it wasn't going too well. And Sir Thomas put down his baton. The donkey had misbehaved on stage, and he said, "Gentlemen of the orchestra, I see our opinion is reflected above."
I only had about 16 bars to sing. And at the end of the second act, all the choruses on the stage, I mean, not only the chorus, but supers as well. I mean, about 80 to 90 people singing away. It's during the scene where the quarrel is on the scene, where villagers come out and start shouting, and Zax is there in the corner, and Beckmesser has been hit to death by the apprentices. I mean, it's such chaos. Aunt Sir Thomas conducting, going, whoop, and whoop, he'd be going. Anyway, the horn of the night watchman sounds, and then all the people on stage disappear into the wings, and there's silence on the stage, and the orchestra that's all you can hear is do 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 do. Well, I think about 3 beats before I was due to come in, Tom was conducting away, and he turned the pages of his score, and he turned to the leader of the orchestra and said, "Where the hell are we?" Well, you can imagine the feeling I had when this voice comes right out of the pit there, and I'm ready to sing, you know. Well, how I came to sing my little bit, I don't know, but that's typical Sir Thomas.
I remember in Aida, for instance, in the duet with Amneris, there's one part that goes very, very quickly, and we always did it very quickly, and I practiced that so much to get the Italian right, to be able to meet his tempi, and it really brought about a marvellous effect. Wonderful.
If a singer was not with him, the singer was not with him. There's never a question that Tommy ought to have been with the singer. And he would leave the singers way, way behind.
Well, if you'll be well. Oh, Helens, now she has crashed! She's crashed!
Ha, 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 ha! Yes, she is smashed! Right! Fool! Ah!
When he made The Tales of Hoffmann, Beecham concerned himself with every aspect of the production.
As he walked into the studio on the lot at Shepperton and said, "I'll have no balancers, I want no balancers, I'll balance it in here." The poor old balancer who had to twiddle the knobs didn't know what to do with himself.
He loved recording. He thought it was one of the most important documentary sides of his whole art. He believed in it. He believed in it partially because it was setting down something which he thought should be preserved. He believed in it partly because, of course, it was the bread and butter of the orchestra. Recordings brought royalties which kept the orchestra going. He believed in it partly because he actually positively enjoyed the idea of hearing and perfecting something which he had perhaps planned before and wanted to know whether it would come out. You know, these test discs would be heard over and over again, and some of them he would pass and some of them he would lay aside. It'd be very difficult sometimes to know on what grounds he would reject some of them. You know, he cost the record companies fortunes in rejections. Some whole sessions would be wasted, and they would be furious, and they'd come round and say, "But Sir Thomas, could you not?" Oh, no, he would be absolutely cavalier in his rejection or what he decided he would have.
You never saw such a complete mess-up in all your life. You know, there was some rather complicated union rules about how many minutes of recorded time we may use and that kind of thing. And he would do a little bit of something and a little bit of something else, and neither he nor anybody else knew by the end of the session exactly what he had recorded. He didn't know himself what he was going to keep, and we didn't know what we'd done at all.
We have a rule that in a three-hour rehearsal, we have to have a quarter of an hour's break in the middle. Well, Tommy couldn't care less about this. I mean, it didn't worry him at all. But when it got to be about 12 o'clock, with the 10 o'clock rehearsal fixed, 10 or 12 o'clock, somebody shouted, "Coffee! Coffee!" So he put his stick down, said, "Coffee! Coffee! He said, you can't make music on coffee." He sat round to the Nag's Head and ordered cases of Guinness and champagne. Well, that was the end of the rehearsal because all the teetotalers were tight.
I will not wait. Where the devil has that fellow got to? Why should we be held up in this damned way? Blasted Teutonic rascal!
Once, during a particularly fraught rehearsal of Goethe Dämmerung, Sir Thomas was pacing the stage like a caged lion.
These second-rate continental singers, when we have enough third-rate singers of our own.
Quietly, from the orchestral pit, a piccolo started to play. A tuba joined in, and in no time, the entire Covent Garden Orchestra was busking the Blue Danube, Sir Thomas conducting with Wagnerian gusto.
This could never happen.
Politicians he saw through instantly and was amused by faked-up Nazi photographs supposedly showing him and Hitler together. In his German concerts, Beecham aggravated the authorities by including music by Jewish composers in his programme. And when Ribbentrop objected to the inclusion of Mendelssohn's Scottish Symphony, Beecham's reply was,
"Why ever not? It was a favourite piece of Queen Victoria's."
But he had his revenge by insisting that Bertha Geismar, his Jewish secretary, who had been hounded by the Nazis, was driven in style, sitting with him in the swastika-bedecked official car.
"In the course of the tour, I was called upon to make 39 speeches, as many as there are in the rubric. And all of them were different. On the other hand, our German hosts made 39 speeches too, but all of them identical, which only goes to show the superior organization of the Teutonic mind.
The disappearance of this universal nightmare will remove the dead weight of spiritually rotting matter that weighs so heavily upon the better nature of the people and enable it to bloom forth again in joy and exuberance.
I should like to make it clear that I am in no wise interested in politics, nor I am a member of any British political party. And in my brief stay in the United States, I have no intention of telling my American friends what I think they ought to do in this war. I'm quite sure they know a great deal better than anybody in England. Although, as I have said, I have no concern with politics, yet for the last 10 years, I, as a patriotic Englishman, have viewed with ever-growing alarm the eccentricities of a succession of feeble-minded and indecisive governments. I think I can say, therefore,
in America, the arts are a racket run by unscrupulous men for unhealthy women."
"Oh, Sir Thomas."
"Somewhere in California, I think it was in Los Angeles, he was invited
by the Women's Committee to lunch. And during lunch, he made several speeches, and they were extremely frank and not to the liking of the ladies. And the ladies began to talk back to him, and then he became more amused, and it ended in a terrible fracas, and everybody was excited, and the ladies were annoyed, and Beecham was amused.
Is that Sir Thomas Beecham?
It is.
Well, Sir Thomas, I know it's kind of late, but I'm the secretary of the English-speaking union in New York, and...
I beg your pardon?
I said I'm the secretary of the English-speaking union in New York.
I don't believe it.
He considered Australia the most barbarous country. When the mayor of Sydney showed him with pride the famous bridge, his comment was,
I don't think I like it at all. Why don't you have it removed?
But on one occasion, entering Broadcasting House in Sydney, he made a special effort to be pleasant.
You're looking very handsome today, my dear.
Oh, Sir Thomas, be your age.
It's already 50 years behind the times. As an artistic convention of any sort, however low, however feeble, how ridiculous, however boosted by the American gossip newspapers and swallowed by the most credulous public the world's ever known in Europe, still, it was born dead. It's only all real use, all right for nightclubs and all that useless crowd of people who ought to be strangled at birth.
What do I think of modern music? What do I think of jazz? Do I like British composers today? How can I answer such a question? They're all friends of mine. The moment I express an opinion, I hurt somebody's feelings. I don't want to do that. I throw the interviewers out. And for that reason, they say I'm crusty. Or the American favorite expression is testy. I am testy. Of course I am. Well, I mean, I remember a young man coming to me one day. I think it was the old Sun newspaper. And he sat and he interviewed me. The interviewer took a singular form. He talked for 40 minutes without stopping. I don't think I got in more than 10 words. At the conclusion, he departed. He said, thank you very much. It should all go in just as you said it. And it did, he'd said.
Your 10
and
words?
Then people, no. Here's 4,000 or 5,000. Then people wonder that I'm tested. I remember a young lady calling upon me to obtain an interview in some remote western university town in Oregon. It was our first assignment, too. We just come out of the high school. There's only one paper in the town. She arrived, sat down, and gawked at me for about 5 minutes. I said, don't be afraid. Just ask me some questions. Oh, questions. Thought another 5 minutes. Then said, tell me, sir, do you collect gramophone records? then they blame me for being tested.
He would talk nonsense if necessary. He wouldn't mind what he said, so long as it was wild and extravagant enough to make people sit up. That's why I think he was taken far too seriously in some of the more outrageous things that he said.
Toscanini, he called...
an Italian bandmaster. A lackey.
Herbert von Karajan.
A sort of musical Malcolm Sargent.
Of Bach.
Too much counterpoint. And moreover, Protestant counterpoint.
Of Vaughan Williams.
I very much like his fantasia on a theme of Thomas Tennant's. Unfortunately, in compositions published subsequently, he omitted to take the precaution of including a theme by Thomas Tennant.
On Bruckner?
He was a hobbledehoy with no sense of style whatsoever.
Of Elgar?
Elgar's music is like the facade of Euston Station.
What about Mahler and Wagner?
They are not civilized.
But he adored Mozart, Berlioz, French lyric opera, Sibelius, and above all else, Delius.
Delius ever conduct his own music?
Well, I have seen in my time good conductors, not so good, competent conductors, indifferent conductors, but I have never come across such an abysmal depth of ineptitude in the way of conducting as revealed by poor old Frederick. It was quite a common thing for him to beat five in the bar when it was four. He beat it 1, 2, 3, 4, and 1, 2, 3, 4, which only did the five. Well, of course, the orchestra became almost distracted. The public became restless. Well, what's going on? What's going on? Something always went on when Delius conducted the work of his own. Something almost outrageous. After a while, he gave it up. But there was a time when he used to practice many hours a day, for weeks at a time, in front of a mirror, endeavouring to understand this mysterious craft.
Yes, but to no purpose.
No purpose at all. I occasionally said, now, Frederick, about this piece, I'd like to ask you what you'd like done here. And he said, well, I can't remember now, but do anything you like with it. Why should you chop me? And I have applied that principle to the work of every other composer.
You know, he wouldn't be serious. And so you would never find out. But don't forget that he was a great reader. About music, I wouldn't like to say. Don't forget that he was a historian, you know? And his reading on history, his knowledge of such matters, and his knowledge of literature was profound.
He would talk to you often as a friend, but he would rarely, I think, reveal his true self, because he was always being, in company, or even in private, a little facetious about this or that. And you never knew if you really had got to the core of the matter. But I would say he revealed himself much more when he stood up and picked up a baton, and this is where you met the man himself, much more than in conversation.
You really knew that he was not acting a part. He was meaning everything he said. And he was like that. If you got inside his character and had an understanding of it, it was absolutely marvelous. You realized that he was the most sincere person. And then, of course, just as quickly, he could be quite insincere. But as I say, it changed rather like the English weather. It was raining one moment, and the sun was shining the next.